conference room on BCTV is supported by Audio Consulting LLC.
Welcome back to our 14th program of the conference room. These are 30-minute programs of high value, high impact, touching on a variety of topics from cybersecurity and its related ideas with liability, risk management, human resources, and strategic management as well, plus much more. And a little bit about the Volander Group is, if we can show that second slide there. I'm Bob Orzechowski. I'm the underwriter with RDO Consulting. My consulting company, we're the underwriters for this conference room program brought to you through the auspices of BCTV and that fine organization as well. The Volander Group, however, we want to show you just who's who in the zoo. It's veteran-owned, first off, and Eric Robuck, who's with us today, the CEO, certified ethical hacker, and he's a candidate for his master's degree in cybersecurity. Chuck Holder is on many of our programs. He's the president. John Robinson, chief financial officer. Myself as chief human resource officer. And Dale Rothenberger, involved with sales, business development, coaching, and risk management topics. A disclaimer here, of course, Volander Group, this is not legal advice. And the opinions expressed here are not necessarily the opinions of BCTV or the underwriters. We ask that you consult with your IT or legal advisors or the Volander Group before making any changes to your IT infrastructure. And with that, we'll go to today's program, The Reality of Cyber Worlds. Here's our learning objectives for today. We're going to focus on these in a narrative, running narrative concept. So we're going to turn it over to Eric here for a moment to begin focusing on these learning objectives. Eric?
Hi, thank you for doing this. I just wanted this program, I really wanted to step back and jump up to maybe a 10,000-foot level and discuss cybersecurity from a 10,000-foot level. I have some web pages that I want to show you. From organizations that track these cybersecurity attacks and different kinds of attacks. And I want to show them to you so we can get an idea of what the climate really is. So if we could go to the computer. This is one, I have multiple websites that I can show you. Here's one of the websites that's tracking different cybersecurity attacks that are happening real time. I want to explain to you how folks can do this. I have multiple of these pages. I want to explain to you how these companies can do this, how they can track these cybersecurity attacks in real time. There's concepts that I would like to discuss. First one's a honeypot. Bob, do you know what a honeypot is?
Maybe not in the terms you're thinking.
Well, a honeypot is a server or a part of a server that's put on a network wide open to the world to try to attract the cyber attacking. Instead of the cyber attack going to your network or your computer, it goes to the honeypot that you set up. So many of these companies have put honeypots throughout the country and throughout the world, and set them up and track who's hitting them and track the attacks that they're getting, and they graphically put it out here so that you can see that. Another way that they can do that is a lot of the antivirus companies have done this, so they can track exactly what's hitting everybody's machines, which means that they can then put it graphically here and see exactly what's going on in the world. So the climate of cybersecurity right now is one of constant attack, constant looking and scanning and grasping at folks that are not secure enough as they should be. They're not secure like they should be, that do not have the knowledge that they should have. So this is one website, and you can see the cyber attacks going back and forth. Let me show you another website. Here's another one doing the exact same thing, and if you can watch on the left, it is showing you exactly the type of attacks that are happening. So I can see different DDoS attacks. I can see different bot attacks. Here's another site, which is even cooler. That is attacks around the world in real time.
So we're basically, most people, most companies are basically fighting a defensive war.
Cybersecurity is always defensive. It's rarely proactive because you have to know the attack before you can defend against it. It's very reactive on the threat side. It's very reactive on the threat actor side, but it's purely reactive. It's very proactive on the threat side. It's very reactive on the defense side because you don't know what's coming, because there are viruses out there that are well known. So somebody may get a hold of that virus, change it just a little bit, and try to throw it out to the world. So when they do that, those virus scanners still pick them up. They still catch them.
So they're reactive to the attack, proactive to the threat.
The bad guys are proactive.
Yes.
The good guys are reactive.
Right.
So the good guys have to look and see what's coming in, what's the new threat. And once they get that new threat, they create a new signature and put it in their antivirus software. That's threats on current genres of attacks, like new viruses, new ransomware attacks.
But it sounds like the honeypot concept then is putting the good guys on the offensive.
Kind of, yeah. Kind of. So a honeypot will sit there and collect data, absolutely, but it's still reactive to what they're sending you.
Okay, yep.
So if I go back to the computer and I look at this, if you look at, I believe it's all the pink, I'm not sure exactly, I didn't get the exact one I wanted up here, but if I were to break this down through type of attack, the number one type of attack that it will be showing me is a scanning attack. So what scanning does is it's somebody sitting there who's written a program. Now remember, people don't sit there in their computers and do these attacks. They write programs to do them.
Right.
Right? So a scanning attack is somebody using a backend like Nmap or something that'll scan IP addresses. So an IP address, everything on the internet has an IP address.
Correct.
Right? So it tells them where your computer is. So there's folks out there that will just put out scans worldwide looking for computers that are wide open. They're looking for computers that are not secure enough. I was just at a company called me Friday and said, oh my goodness, I think we got attacked. Can you come in and help me? So I came in and I did what I needed to do, and I had a long conversation with the organization, the head of the organization, and a couple things that she asked me were very enlightening to what folks actually think. One of the questions she said is, why do they want me? Why are they going to attack me? And I had to explain to her, they don't even know you, nor do they care about you. They want your computer. And if they did know you, right? It's a small organization. If they did know you, they would still want you because you have data that's important to you. It may not be important to other people, but it's so important to you that if they took it, you would pay to get it back, which is ransomware.
Right.
Right. So if you are not secure enough, these scans are going to find you. They're out sooner or later, a scan is going to find your machine because they're out there by the thousands running constantly.
4,000 ransomware attacks a day, I've read.
And that doesn't surprise me in the least. There may be 100,000 scannings going on every day or more. I think I saw that each day we're up to 4 million cybersecurity attacks of some kind. Some a scan, some just pinging and looking, some ransomware, somebody downloaded a bot or downloaded virus,
right.
And it will certainly get you if you do not respond like you should to this current environment. If you look up there, that should give you an idea or a picture of the current environment, because as we sit here and you and I sit here, we don't see this. This is all invisible. It's almost like the coronavirus.
Now, are the colors indicative of certain strengths, frequencies?
I think that this particular threat map, the colors are indicative of countries. But there are plenty of other threat maps. If I look at this one on the left, you can see the colors are indicative of different kinds of attacks.
Ah.
On this one, you can see down here the same thing. The colors are indicative of different kinds of attacks. So you can actually find these maps that you can customize to say, just show me this attack and just show me that attack. But if you're just looking at that, first of all, this one's very, very cool. It's certainly not representative of everything that's going on. None of them are, because they have their own systems. They have their own antivirus. So if you imagine that Kaspersky has it out there where they have a nice threat map, and McAfee could have one, and Norton could have one, and if you put them all together, you probably wouldn't even be able to see the map. There's so much stuff going on out there.
Right.
There are so many scans going on, just pinging and looking for you and looking to see, is your computer secure? And as they're scanning, they could be collecting data. So if they're collecting data on you and you're not well encrypted, they can get your password. They can get, if you go to Google is not what you think it is. It's a little bit different of a subject. I can search Google in a way that I can find all sorts of things that I'm not supposed to have. So you have to be secure. If you are not secure, these cybersecurity criminals, the one thing that the lady said to me is they can't be that smart. Let me tell you, the person that I just went to Friday, let me tell you, they are incredibly smart. This is not the criminals of your great grandfather who grabbed the gun and
stole
stupidly
cattle or something.
Stole cattle. These are brilliant, brilliant people. I was talking to a detective the other day in cybersecurity, and he told me bank robberies are rare anymore. They don't happen because it's so much easier.
Show up with a mask, a ski mask, and a pistol.
How much risk is that? How much risk is going with a pistol, a ski map, as opposed to sitting on a computer
and transferring funds?
And transferring funds and running these scans and figuring out exactly what you're doing so that I can attack you.
Well, we understand certainly the motivations. It's generally money. It's not power. It's not ego. Hey, I can do this and no harm, no foul. It's money. Okay.
Partially, absolutely. There's other motivations too.
Well,
but
what do you think they are?
Everything goes back to money. But a lot of the motivation is so competitors. So if you have a company, a competitor wants to either know what you're doing and how you're doing it, steal your intellectual property, or use a DDoS, which stands for denial of service attack. A DDoS is a distributed denial of service attack, which I can explain in a second, to bring your company down, to bring your company to its knees. Let me take just two or three minutes to explain what a denial of service attack is. This is more towards companies and less towards individuals. So a denial of service attack is an attack on a company to bring their network down. The way that is done is that I may be sitting on my computer, have a program on my computer that'll start pinging, start asking your computer questions and doing it at such a high rate that it overwhelms it. Well, that denial of service attack is very, very easy to foil because, like I said, I have an IP address. I have an address on the internet. So the security folks can go in there and they can just say, don't allow my IP address in. So the way the bad guys...
Blacklisting.
Yes, blacklisting. The way the bad guys get around that is they put something out there called bots. So they'll put a bot out there. They'll put a web page out there and put a bot in it. So you go to the web page and you're not paying attention or doing what you should do, or you get an email and you click on what you shouldn't click, a bot is downloaded to your web, to your machine, and it just sits there and does nothing. Right? So they send out 100,000 bots. That's called that's getting ready for a denial, a distributed denial of service attack. So somebody's sitting back with their finger on their computer, getting ready to activate all these bots. He's called a bot herder of all things. As soon as they press that button, all those machines go after one company, and they can't go in and just get rid, blacklist one IP address, because they're getting maybe 50,000 IP addresses hitting them. And one of them could be yours, because you clicked on the wrong thing. You didn't understand the current climate and what we're doing. So you have a bot on your machine helping to take down a company that's just trying to survive. The bad guys have gotten you. So it's not just money. It's enslaving your machine to go after competitors.
So are bots a version of phishing?
Phishing is how a bot will get on your computer.
Right.
Right? So I'll send you an email, and we can talk far more about social engineering, but through social engineering and through phishing, I can get a bot on your computer through email. You click on the wrong thing, it's on your computer. That bot is malware, and it sits there, and you don't know it's there until the bot herder says go, and you still don't really know it's there. Your computer may start acting a bit funny, and you may be looking and saying, what's going on with my computer? Let me tell you, let me look at you and tell you, if something feels funny on your computer, it probably is, right? So you want to call somebody and say, what's going on? Can you look at my task manager? Can you look at all the things that are running on my computer and make sure all of them are legitimate? So that's another reason, trying to take other people down. Revenge is another reason. There's all sorts of people out there that want to get revenge on possibly somebody that fired them, possibly an ex-partner, an ex-girlfriend, an ex-boyfriend, and you could unwittingly be a part of that. But you're right. By far, money is the greatest motivator. If you're not paying attention, people can easily, bad guys can easily get your account numbers to your banks and all your passwords, and just slowly but surely just whittle away and take everything that you have.
Well, you're painting a terrifying picture. In the time we have left, we do want to devote some time to people are out there panicking, saying, what can I do? This is all way above me. This is above our pay grade. I use the computer now, especially with remote working from home. What can people do?
There's a multi-step plan I have for you. The first one is understand and educate. Understand what I'm teaching you here. Understand what's going on. Understand that the cyber criminals are not stupid. They are very, very smart. They're smarter than you and I, because there's millions of them.
Not the old-time bootleggers.
They're not bootleggers. Absolutely. The second, make sure your passwords are secure. Make sure your passwords are secure. We've done a show on passwords. If they're not secure, you are in trouble. The third, make sure you can recognize and understand what a phishing email is. Right. Mm-hmm. Make sure you recognize, understand what a vishing attack is. So somebody, you get all these phone calls on your phone, right? And people can, and they're bad guys probing you, saying, "Oh, come get, you know, we need your car warranty. You, what do you want? You know, I want to tell you a couple things. Number one, you didn't win a prize. You have not won a prize." The police aren't going to call you to arrest you. That's just not the way life works. The IRS is not going to call you. Don't take the wrong phone call. They're social engineering phone calls. They're looking for information. If they ask you for your social security number, which I know people have given them, say no and hang up. Don't call that. You mean they're generally overseas.
I don't even answer some of those things. And
that's
they,
right.
You know, but I'll text them back. You know, stop calling me or something.
Right. Let me talk a little bit about all these annoying updates to your computer. They are so annoying. But if you don't take care of them and you don't run them, you are in trouble. The way what these updates are, sometimes they're functionality updates, but generally there's been an attack, and say Microsoft has been attacked, and they see what the person did to attack them, and they make a fix and send it out to you. So if you're not doing your updates, the bad guy already knows that it's going to work. So they attacked a machine, Microsoft sent the update, and now these bad guys are out there looking for people that didn't run the update. So those scans are running, and they're saying, did you do the update? If you didn't do the update, I gotcha. So when it says update your computer, update your computer.
Yeah, a lot of times when I go to log off or shut down, it'll say update and shut down.
Yes, or update and reboot.
Right.
Do that. Make sure you do that. Make sure you do that for software programs many times. Have
right.
that. They ask you to update. Adobe is famous for it. Java is famous for it. But don't take an email that says, click here to download and update Adobe. That's a way people get you in phishing.
Right. Yep. And I get those probably once a week. Many times they're from legitimate people I know who have been hacked, and there would be this in big capital blue or red letters, click here for this information.
Absolutely.
On this RFP, and it's somebody I know.
Absolutely. And the reason it's somebody you know is because somebody you know did not take care of their passwords.
Right.
And somebody got a hold of their passwords and got into their it's called an SMTP server, got into their mail server and
right.
are able to send that out. Or another thing, pay close attention to who's sending you emails. If my company's email address is Valander, right? Somebody could go in and buy, it's called typo squatting. They buy another domain name with something just a little different. Maybe the E's missing in Valander. And they'll make it from bob@valander.com. And it looks just like yours, but it's one letter off. So somebody looks at it quickly, oh, this is from Bob. I can click on this. Make sure you look at everything that everybody
right.
says you sends you very closely. Because again,
yep.
this is about social engineering. This is about psychology. They are studying how people act and what they do under certain circumstances. And then they come after you with that, armed with that
right.
information.
So with all the tools, defending computers, putting moats and castle walls around the computers. Still, if you have an employee who's asleep on duty, none of that matters.
Absolutely, absolutely. And it's not just if they're asleep on duty. That's true. It's not just asleep on duty. It's that they got specifically targeted in your company. So suppose I'm a dad and I have a child that's extraordinarily intelligent, and I put a bumper sticker on my car that says my middle schooler is a genius, and I'm a bad guy and I see that starts my attack. I want to find everything out that I can find out about you to be able to send you an email that says, I heard your middle schooler is a genius. Click here so you can apply for the National Merit Scholarship. Or I love my dog. Well, click here to find out how to train your dog. You want to give out as least information
right.
as you possibly can about yourself.
You know, one thing we haven't really touched, we're talking about computers, laptops, workstation, servers. Can you talk a moment about, in the time we have left, the Internet of Things?
Okay, so the Internet of Things is the least secure genre out there. The Internet of Things are things that are on your, like in your house. So you may have a thermostat that's controlled through the internet and your phone, or you may have
your phone as well.
Well, your phone's not, I don't believe, is considered your Internet of Things. That's a different thing. If we're talking about the Internet of Things, we're talking about maybe my fish tank has a thermometer that I can check over my phone to see if, to make sure that the temperature's right. Or maybe I can come in and click a button here and my lights go off. A much bigger thing is maybe I have a security system in my house that is all through the internet. Those are all the Internet of Things. You have to make sure
the Ring doorbell.
Ring doorbell. You have to make sure they all have passwords to get in. You have to make sure that you change the default password that comes with it. It may be admin. But whatever it is, it's simple and it's on the internet. So when somebody installs that for you, you have to say, did you take out the admin password? Did you take out the admin username and password, or change that password? because it's very easy to break into your house just to sit out in front of your house and you'll never see me. And I will be breaking into your entire network in your house because of the Internet of Things.
Okay. It's kind of frightening, of course. So we have employers that have employees. We have employees working from home, employees working in the offices and factories. But we also have individuals who may be retired, or they're simply, or these school kids that are working from home, that are remote learning now, virtual learning. We've just increased the vulnerability, the opportunities for the bad guys exponentially.
Absolutely. I was just at a company the other day, and they told me that their policy was BYOD, bring your own device. The people could bring their own devices, and they were allowing them to plug right into their network with no security. That is an enormous mistake. Same thing about remote working. You have to secure that, because if you don't, everybody's security issues now became your security issues.
Right. I guess we need some takeaways here in the 2 minutes we have left. I know you can't repeat everything in the next 2 minutes, but where do you begin if this is a cold shower for you before you've gotten hit? Where does somebody begin? Calling you?
Calling me? Absolutely. You can call me. I am a cyber coach also. I'll come and help you. But if I've scared people, I've done my job, because it's a scary world.
Right.
Educate yourself. Help your mother and father who may be elderly and don't understand and don't want to understand. You need to help them. You need to be on YouTube, and you need to be on the internet educating yourself on these things. You need to update your machine and change your passwords and use a password manager. Those are the biggest things that I can tell you to do. Now, I just told you what to do from a 20,000-foot view. That's almost like saying, make sure you use your brakes on your car. There's much more to it.
Right.
But those are my biggest takeaways that I can give you.
Okay. It's like the only advice I gave my kids when they were learning to drive was stay awake, stay alive.
Right. Right. Absolutely.
Everything else you can learn.
But I would say that if your passwords are correct, you've just fought a lot of the battle. Right.
And we'll have to draw you to the valandergroup.com. We did a program on passwords probably back in July, so you can find that. I think it was our third program. So we want to thank the people here at BCTV, John and Joan behind the cameras and in the engineering booth. BCTV is a great organization, deserves your support. And these programs run the second Wednesday and fourth Tuesday of every month. And we're working on a whole new set of these programs for you. We want to bring up the last slide there about the Valander Group, and we thank you for your attention. If you have questions, there we go. You can send them to questions@valandergroup.com. There's a phone number there, 484-638-4053. You can visit us at the www.valandergroup.com. In the resource page, we do have these conference room programs. They're 30 minutes in duration to keep your attention and provide some organizational improvements for you as well. And again, Bob Orzechowski, the underwriter, RDO Consulting. And my contact information is there as well. And we'll get you set up and secure and safe and profitable and functional and all those good things. So thanks very much, Eric, CEO and founder of the Valander Group. And we'll look forward to many more of these programs and be scared once again. Thank you. Goodbye.
The conference room on BCTV is supported by RDO Consulting, LLC.